From Avery Fisher Hall at Lincoln Center, welcome to the 1991 Richard Tucker Opera Gala, starring Harolyn Blackwell, Renee Fleming, Denise Graves, Jerry Hadley, Marilyn Horne, Dmitry Khoroshovsky, Chris Merritt, Leonucci, Elena Obratsova, Luciano Pavarotti, Roberta Peters, Paul Plischka, Sam Raimi, Diana Soviero, with members of the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra, the Collegiate Chorale, conductors Christian Badia, Robert Bass, and James Conlon. Now, our host for the evening, Roberta Peters.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Richard Tucker Music Foundation's 15th anniversary concert. I'm Roberta Peters. Thank you, thank you. And I'm delighted to be here this evening in Fisher Hall at Lincoln Center to honor the memory of my dear friend and colleague, the wonderful American tenor, Mr. Richard Tucker. Richard believed in sharing his gifts, not only on the stage, but also by making himself available to teach and encourage young singers. He felt strongly that Americans should not have to go to Europe to make a career for themselves. That's why, after Richard's untimely death, his friends, family, and colleagues established the Richard Tucker Music Foundation to assist the careers of young American singers. The opera stars who are with us this evening share this sentiment, and I'm thrilled that they could all be here tonight to salute Richard by performing and assisting those wonderful young artists. Richard Tucker was one of the glories of the Metropolitan Opera from 1945 until his untimely death 30 years later. Richard Tucker made his debut at La Scala in Louisa Miller in 1969. There was a young tenor, a young Italian tenor in the audience named Luciano Pavarotti. Luciano adored Tucker, and he has since made something of a name for himself. He's with us tonight with conductor James Conlon to sing two arias by Puccini, Ch'ella mi creda, from The Girl of the Golden West, and Addio Fiorito Asil, from Madama Butterfly. Please welcome Luciano Pavarotti. And now, please welcome another great American singer and friend of Richard Tucker, Miss Marilyn Horne, who will sing Sorge l'irato nembo from Vivaldi's Orlando Furioso, with James Conlon conducting members of the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra.
Con con de cielo e mare.
The Tucker Foundation keeps the memory of a great singer alive by helping young talent. We have 6 Tucker winners with us this evening, including Harolyn Blackwell, the sparkling young soprano who has won 2 grants and is now making a splash at the Met in such roles as Oscar in The Masked Ball, one of the roles that's especially close to my heart since I've done it at the Metropolitan Opera many, many times. Please welcome Harolyn Blackwell, who will sing Norina's feisty Quel guardo il cavaliere from Donizetti's Don Pasquale, conducted by Robert Bass. Harolyn Blackwell.
Thank you.
I never realized that our next guest, Sam Raimi, sang with Richard Tucker. They did several performances of La Gioconda together. Here, Sam is in one of his signature roles, Verdi's Attila, singing Mentre gonfiarsi l'anima. Christian Badia is the conductor.
petto ad attilo.
We will return with more of the 1991 Richard Tucker Opera Gala, with performances by this year's award winner Renee Fleming, Chris Merritt, Dmitri Horoshkovsky, and Luciano Pavarotti.
The reasons we're here this evening is to introduce this year's Tucker winner, soprano Renee Fleming, a captivating young performer who will sing the beautiful song To the Moon from Dvorak's opera Rusalka. Christian Badia conducts.
Thank you.
The tenor Chris Merritt won his Tucker Grant in 1985 and now moves with astonishing ease in the high wire world of Rossini and Donizetti's Bel Canto. Here's Chris to sing an aria from Donizetti's wonderful romp, The Daughter of the Regiment. Ah, mes amis pour mon âme. Christian Badia is our conductor. The sudden appearance of a new and exciting talent is one of the great thrills of opera. The Siberian baritone, Dmitri Hvorostovsky, has provided the opera world with just such a treat recently, and I'm especially delighted that he could be with us tonight. And now, Dmitri Hvorostovsky will give us Carlo Ascolta from Verdi's Don Carlo, with Christian Badia conducting.
Thank you.
And now, Maestro Conlon will lead Diana Soviero, Denise Graves, Jerry Hadley, Leo Nucci, Alan Held, Jeff Matzi, Philip Kokorinos, Charles Anthony, members of the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra and the Collegiate Chorale in the poignant finale of Act Three of Verdi's La Traviata.
Questa notte Orrore, gelosa smania, deluso amore, mi straffia l'alma, più non ragiono, no, lei perdono, più non avrò, volle a fuggirla, non ho potuto, dalli la spinto, son qui venuto, or che lo sdegno ho di sfogato, m'è sciagurato, rimorso, no.
Thank you.
grazie all'alba. Più non è
Richard Tucker Opera Gala will return with performances by Paul Pliska, Elena Obrazova, and Luciano Pavarotti. Now your local public television station will tell you how you can express your appreciation for this program. The program received special funding from National Westminster Bancorp and its subsidiaries. Welcome back to Avery Fisher Hall at Lincoln Center and the 1991 Richard Tucker Opera Gala. Once again, Roberta Peters.
When Paul Pliska got to the Met in 1967, Richard Tucker was starring there. The two rehearsed, they dueled together on the stage and sang together. Paul's with us tonight to sing the great bass aria from Verdi's Nabucco, Nel futuro, nel buio di Cerno, with Christian Badia conducting.
Rotta d'inverno
next guest appeared on the very first Taka Gala in 1976. And it's with great delight that I welcome back the Russian mezzo-soprano, Elena Obratsova, who will sing the Easter hymn and prayer from Mascagni's Cavalleria. She will be joined by the Collegiate Chorale with Christian Badia conducting. And once again, that great artist and friend to young singers, Luciano Pavarotti, with the Lamento di Federico from Chile's La Resiana. James Conlon conducts the orchestra.
la storia del pastore. Il povero ragazzo voleva raccontarla,
return with the grand finale of the 1991 Richard Tucker Opera Gala. Now your local public television station will tell you how you can express your appreciation for this program.
Winning this competition bolstered me quite a bit emotionally.
In the beginning stages, you have to do so many odd jobs. I started as a secretary.
I did all kinds of temporary work. I did church jobs, anything.
I sang jazz for a couple of years. I worked as a secretary and did some teaching. And mainly just stuck it out and kept working really hard.
And now we'd like to bring back this year's Tucker winner, Renee Fleming, who's already shining on stages here and abroad. The Ballatella from Leoncavallo's Pagliacci, Robert Bass conducting. Please welcome Renee Fleming.
Thank you.
And now, returning to our stage, Dmitri Hovorostovsky, who will join Luciano Pavarotti, James Conlon, and the orchestra for Invano Alvaro from Verdi's La Forza del Destino. Please welcome him.
sola rilasciasti e tradita abbandonasti e tradita abbandonasti alle fammi al disonore.
Bella d'un poeta non disprezzate Our musical tributes continue this March pledge-free night with music by Richard Rodgers when Shirley Jones, Marvin Hamlisch, Andrew Lloyd Webber, and Richard Kiley gather to celebrate Oklahoma, The Sound of Music, My Fair Lady, and South Pacific. Scenes from these musicals in a few minutes this Friday night here on Channel 9.
This program received special funding from National Westminster Bancorp and its subsidiaries. Great Performances is made possible by Texaco, continuing our tradition of leadership in supporting the finest in performing arts. Texaco, star of the American road. And Martin Marietta, dedicated to excellence in aerospace, electronics, information management, and materials. Great Performances is also made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by the support of viewers like you.
Here to tell us about Warren Jones. Good morning.
Good morning, Charles.
What sort of fellow is this to whom great singers go to what, to learn even more?
Warren Jones is only 39 years old, and he's a marvelous pianist and a wonderful musician who really thinks that singing is, in his words, hysterical fun. And he has a very human approach to the art of singing. He tells a story about a debut recital that he accompanied, a soprano. And in the very opening aria, he played the introduction and she simply stood there frozen. He played the introduction again and he looked up and there she was, frozen with fear. So he simply turned to the audience and said, "Excuse me." He walked over to her, he touched her hand, he smiled at her, he showed her the music, and then he turned to the audience and he said, "I think we'll start again, this time for real."
Ah, yeah. Well, does it make him then principally reassurer of singers?
He really is neither a guru or a teacher. He is a collaborative artist, a truly equal partner with these singers. He explores the music with them and he allows them to sing their best and to give to the audience the best that they have to give. Luciano Pavarotti will soon be performing the role of Otello, which he is rehearsing with Warren Jones. Marilyn Horne and Warren Jones are putting their many hours of rehearsals to work, captivating an audience. It has taken Carol Van Ness weeks of practice to become Anna Bolena. The great stars project an ease and grandeur that takes a lot of hard work. And for Carol Van Ness, when there is work to be done, you frequently find Warren Jones there.
I try to work all of my new parts with Warren. He understands my voice, he understands my personality. And these kind of parts, it's very crucial to have someone who does, because you need to bring your own personality and your own voice to it.
You can take a better breath before...
I see many people who are working in the kind of job I'm doing who have almost an adversarial relationship with singers. And that never works in the long run. You have to love that personality and love that peculiar, that particular set of crazinesses that comes with being a singer. And I do.
Warren Jones is a vocal coach and an established recital accompanist, a performer himself. But most of all, he is someone who loves singing and singers.
often people think that singers are the most neurotic of the musician clan, and they generally are, with good reason. Imagine the fact that you, as Eugenia Zuckerman, you can never hear what your voice sounds like. When you play the flute, you can hear what the flute sounds like, but you can never hear your voice. And a singer is engaging in a physical activity, but they have no idea what it's like. And they rely on someone to tell them everything they're doing.
There should be a rest, beat.
And singers know that they are in good hands with Warren Jones. He served as assistant conductor at the Metropolitan Opera for 10 years. There's very little about music he doesn't know.
That's it. You hear the difference? Because you want that kind of slight craziness underneath you.
Jones began to study piano when he was 5, but he never took voice lessons.
Inflect your melody the same way her words are.
From the time I was 7 until I was 14, I participated with my sisters in a gospel trio. And we were fairly well known around North Carolina, where my family lives, and sang quite a bit around churches and also major gospel singings. I learned such a great deal there because I was also the MC of the group, being sort of show off. And so I was singing and playing and talking to 2,000 or 3,000 people at a time.
You're going to want to do different things if you want to create a different mood with a different text. There are times when you're
the speaking ability he developed as a youngster has served him well in the master classes he gives, such as this one at the Cleveland Institute of Music.
Because you want the energy there, you are calling on the waterfall, you are calling on the Nachtigall, right? You want some more energy. If you had the chance in there, you might do exactly what you did in the beginning.
But he shows the same enthusiasm with young singers as he does with more established singers.
And I feel like I have a responsibility to help other people discover themselves and discover the wonderful things about music that they can do to the best of their ability. And that's what I like to do as a teacher.
But what must a singer have to be able to move people?
The first thing on my list of that is a voice that is either beautiful or somehow interesting.
Beautiful and interesting can certainly be used to describe Luciano Pavarotti's voice.
Luciano, for example, has an incredible presence in his voice where you can sit in the back row of the Metropolitan Opera and it feels like he's singing just for you. And you can hear that presence in his voice, even in his own living room. And so you want to make sure, if you're in my position, you want to make sure that the way he learns it the first time is the correct way. Because the way he learns it today is going to show in 5 years, because he won't forget it.
I would like to have a man of heaven in my own heart.
Jones spends much of his time collaborating with singers for recitals. Here he is with Roberta Alexander before her New York recital debut.
Like people from every corner of heaven.
Let's do one more time at the beginning, if you don't mind.
Rehearsals aren't about dotting every I and crossing every T and making sure each rubato is here. It's to get to know what her voice feels like, what my piano playing feels like, so that when we are in public, and we have all the people out there who have paid to see us do something, we just let things happen.
What is wonderful about a pianist like Warren is that you go out, you can stand up there, and all you have to do is think about communicating with your audience, because this person, you'll be like one person. That's fantastic.
Warren Jones loves what he does, but it's hard not to wonder if he ever wanted to be a piano soloist.
I don't enjoy doing that. I love to be out there and share the center with somebody. I love that. But I don't have that kind of personality to do it myself.
All of the singers that he works with are fortunate that he feels that way, and they know it. Carol Van Ness.
You know, in Italy, they have a statement before you walk on the stage. They say, in bocca al lupo, which means in the mouth of the wolf. That means as you walk onto the stage, you are now walking into the mouth of the wolf. And what you say is you say, crepi lupo, you know, let the wolf die. And, you know, Warren is the person who sends you out with the ammunition to kill the wolf.
Here to tell us about Warren Jones. Good morning.
Good morning, Charles.
What sort of fellow is this to whom great singers go to what, to learn even more?
Warren Jones is only 39 years old, and he's a marvelous pianist and a wonderful musician who really thinks that singing is, in his words, hysterical fun. And he has a very human approach to the art of singing. He tells a story about a debut recital that he accompanied, a soprano. And in the very opening aria, he played the introduction and she simply stood there frozen. He played the introduction again and he looked up and there she was, frozen with fear. So he simply turned to the audience and said, "Excuse me." He walked over to her, he touched her hand, he smiled at her, he showed her the music, and then he turned to the audience and he said, "I think we'll start again, this time for real."
Ah, yeah. Well, does it make him then principally reassurer of singers?
He really is neither a guru or a teacher. He is a collaborative artist, a truly equal partner with these singers. He explores the music with them and he allows them to sing their best and to give to the audience the best that they have to give. Luciano Pavarotti will soon be performing the role of Otello, which he is rehearsing with Warren Jones. Marilyn Horne and Warren Jones are putting their many hours of rehearsals to work, captivating an audience. It has taken Carol Van Ness weeks of practice to become Anna Bolena. The great stars project an ease and grandeur that takes a lot of hard work. And for Carol Van Ness, when there is work to be done, you frequently find Warren Jones there.
I try to work all of my new parts with Warren. He understands my voice, he understands my personality. And these kind of parts, it's very crucial to have someone who does, because you need to bring your own personality and your own voice to it.
You can take a better breath before fin la scoria me concessa, lo neghe il re.
I see many people who are working in the kind of job I'm doing who have almost an adversarial relationship with singers. And that never works in the long run. You have to love that personality and love that peculiar, that particular set of crazinesses that comes with being a singer. And I do.
Warren Jones is a vocal coach and an established recital accompanist, a performer himself. But most of all, he is someone who loves singing and singers.
often people think that singers are the most neurotic of the musician clan, and they generally are, with good reason. Imagine the fact that you, as Eugenia Zuckerman, you can never hear what your voice sounds like. When you play the flute, you can hear what the flute sounds like, but you can never hear your voice. And a singer is engaging in a physical activity, but they have no idea what it's like. And they rely on someone to tell them everything they're doing.
There should be a rest, beat.
And singers know that they are in good hands with Warren Jones. He served as assistant conductor at the Metropolitan Opera for 10 years. There's very little about music he doesn't know.
That's it. You hear the difference? Because you want that kind of slight craziness underneath you.
Jones began to study piano when he was 5, but he never took voice lessons.
Inflect your melody the same way her words are.
From the time I was 7 until I was 14, I participated with my sisters in a gospel trio. And we were fairly well known around North Carolina, where my family lives, and sang quite a bit around churches and also major gospel singings. I learned such a great deal there because I was also the MC of the group, being sort of show off. And so I was singing and playing and talking to 2,000 or 3,000 people at a time.
You're going to want to do different things if you want to create a different mood with a different text. There are times when you're
the speaking ability he developed as a youngster has served him well in the master classes he gives, such as this one at the Cleveland Institute of Music.
Because you want the energy there. You are calling on the waterfall. You are calling on the Nachtigall, right? Okay. You want some more energy. If you had the chance in there, you might do exactly what you did in the beginning.
But he shows the same enthusiasm with young singers as he does with more established singers.
And I feel like I have a responsibility to help other people discover themselves and discover the wonderful things about music that they can do to the best of their ability. And that's what I like to do as a teacher.
But what must a singer have to be able to move people?
The first thing on my list of that is a voice that is either beautiful or somehow interesting.
Beautiful and interesting can certainly be used to describe Luciano Pavarotti's voice.
Luciano, for example, has an incredible presence in his voice where you can sit in the back row of the Metropolitan Opera and it feels like he's singing just for you. And you can hear that presence in his voice, even in his own living room. And so you want to make sure, if you're in my position, you want to make sure that the way he learns it the first time is the correct way. Because the way he learns it today is going to show in 5 years, because he won't forget it.
I would like to have a man of heaven in my own heart.
Jones spends much of his time collaborating with singers for recitals. Here he is with Roberta Alexander before her New York recital debut.
Like people from every corner of heaven.
Let's do one more time at the beginning, if you don't mind.
Rehearsals aren't about dotting every I and crossing every T and making sure each rubato is here. It's to get to know what her voice feels like, what my piano playing feels like, so that when we are in public, and we have all the people out there who have paid to see us do something, we just let things happen.
What is wonderful about a pianist like Warren is that you go out, you can stand up there, and all you have to do is think about communicating with your audience, because this person, you'll be like one person. That's fantastic.
Warren Jones loves what he does, but it's hard not to wonder if he ever wanted to be a piano soloist.
I don't enjoy doing that. I love to be out there and share the center with somebody. I love that. But I don't have that kind of personality to do it myself.
All of the singers that he works with are fortunate that he feels that way, and they know it. Carol Vanez.
You know, in Italy, they have a statement before you walk on the stage. They say, in bocca al lupo, which means in the mouth of the wolf. That means as you walk under the stage, you are now walking into the mouth of the wolf. And what you say is you say, crepi lupo, you know, let the wolf die. And, you know, Warren is the person who sends you out with the ammunition to kill the wolf.